Well, a council in South Australia has this week become the third in the state to remove Welcome to Country from its council meetings. It's replaced it with a more inclusive statement that does not expressly mention Indigenous people. More and more councils across the country are vowing to follow suit. Welcome to Countries have become so commonplace at meetings, events, gatherings. You hear it on the PA when a plane lands, even when you click on some websites. And it doesn't come cheap either. Thousands in taxpayer dollars are spent on Welcome to Country ceremonies at government events. On Friday, RSL Queensland copped backlash over its planned Anzac Day Welcome to Country. Barnaby Joyce decried it as the politicisation of our national commemorative day. Our next question for the jury, does Welcome to Country make people feel unwelcome in their own country? Joining me now is leading No Voice referendum campaigner Warren Mundine and Nathan Moran, CEO of the Metropolitan Local Aboriginal Land Council. Great to see you both. Thank you so much joining us on the panel this evening. Warren, we'll start with you. You think Welcome to Country has become trivialised because it's been so overused, but you also think it's become divisive. Why?
Look, I think it's become trivialised because it is a very important thing. I think it's really, used in the right context. In the sense of it becoming divisive, as some people are starting to feel that, well, what about us, we've been here for a while as well, this is our country and everything like that.
Why does Welcome to Country, or what does it do actually to help First Nations people, in your view?
Well, firstly, it allows us to start a relationship. It connects non-Aboriginal and Aboriginal people generally. But in a traditional sense, Welcome to Countries are a bit different today to what happened, say, pre-contact. Traditionally, people had to have authorisation or at least be welcomed into one's country. They either carried a message stick that authorised them on behalf of their people to enter another's land, or they were invited. Without that, you'd have a much stricter border control than what you see today. So today, Welcome to Countries is certainly something that's emerged in our lifetime since the 70s, acknowledging the great Richard Wally and Ernie Dingo.
Yes.
And the Bundjalung mob in the 70s who started providing these and acknowledging that it's something that's very common in the South Pacific. Our Polynesian and Melanesian neighbours have done this continuously since the day of dawn.
Yeah.
And it's something that is part of this part of the world.
Yeah.
So it's... For me, it's something that I'm intrigued by hearing about divisive. I don't think it's about divisive.
You don't think it's about divisive?
I think it's about inclusion.
Yep.
I am concerned about trivialising it not being respected, delivered in an appropriate way.
Right. So you don't think it makes people feel unwelcome in their own country?
I think it's about understanding the context. I think it also may impact on the delivery of what's being said.
Okay.
But I think the intention of it and the importance of it, I hope, can become more clear.
I think the trivialisation of it, that's the problem. We should be doing proper welcomes and that. And you shouldn't have to do it at every meeting and every... Well, look, I go to some conferences and you spend half the day doing Welcome to the Country. The first section, the traditional owners have been there, and the elders, they've welcomed you. Let's get on with the conference and start talking about the business of the day. But when you just got every person doing the same thing over and over and over, then people sort of get turned off by it all, and that's where I'm concerned about that trivialisation.
Nathan, I mean, just to go on that point, how do you feel about that? Because do you worry that people are more likely to ignore issues facing First Nations people if it's constantly jammed down our throats that Welcome to Country?
Yeah, I just hope it's delivered in the right way by the right people. Yeah. For myself, as a representative of the Aboriginal community, we're a democratic community.
Yeah.
We have elected representatives who go out and represent us. My concern is those things when they're not done by those who are authorised for community.
Yes.
People must be the actual community representatives delivering welcomes and or acknowledgements to people. Mm-hmm. I am concerned, but that people just repeating it does downplay the importance of it. Mm-hmm. Although I acknowledge the fine line between one trying to respect it and honour it.
Yes.
Versus, maybe just repetitively saying something that then becomes nearly meaningless at the end of the day is a great concern.
It's of great concern. Let's see how the jury's feeling. Rob, what do you think about Welcome to Country?
Difficult one.
Yeah.
Very much with Warren on this one, and thank you for your work on the voice. There is the feeling that it's making a lot of people uncomfortable in their own country. And I can see where they get that notion from. But I think the bigger issue for me, while the actual Welcome to Country is a wonderful thing. I think the activism, the radical activism that sometimes flows from some areas of the Aboriginal community that always was, always will be sort of statements, that's the thing that I think is turning a lot of people off and saying, hey, it's my country too, I've bought land, it's in my name sort of thing. It's the radical side and the divisive side that, yeah, I believe in one nation, one country, one flag, one vote sort of notion, and I think it flows
right
down that track, and it diminishes the hard work that we need to do with our
Aboriginal
community.
Well, Nathan, what do you think? Because I notice you've got that printed on your shirt. Always was, always
proudly,
will be. Yes.
Acknowledging the Red Fern community from the 70s.
What do you think?
That this has been a catch cry of the community since the 70s. Certainly founded in movements in Red Fern here in Sydney and Gadigal country. The always was and will be was just a slogan to really replicate, to represent who we are and what we are. Certainly acknowledging in the 70s, we were still at a time. There was no racial discrimination acts then to protect one's rights to not be discriminated against. We came out of a time when we were still trying to call for rights. It predates land rights, native title. Mm. And acknowledging it was only 1992 and 3 that this country accepted that we were human, that we existed, and we're still on a very long journey. And I think that there's still a lot to come from the Eddie Mabo decision that we haven't pragmatically and practically sat down as human beings and acknowledged we were here.
It's time to call on the jury. You have 10 seconds to deliberate. Does welcome to country make people feel unwelcome in their own country? Time is up. What is the jury's verdict? Okay, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 no's, and the rest of you said yes, you believe does welcome to country make people feel unwelcome in your own country. Charlotte, you voted no. You're shaking your head there. What? Why?
Absolutely not. Like, I'm a white Australian. My family's been here for generations, and I've never once felt unwelcome by the welcome to country. I think it's so important that non-Indigenous Australians have empathy and are so open to having discussions and acknowledging the history of the country that we live on, and that is a part of being welcomed by the Indigenous community. And I think, you know, as from previous comments, I think it does bring out a sense of fear, I guess, in some people, because they think that by acknowledging that history, there's going to be backlash and it's going to impact our way of living now. But I think on the flip side of that, it can bring us all together if we just lead with empathy and actually are open to having conversations and acknowledging what has happened.
Sandra, in the back row, you're shaking your head there. You don't agree with what Charlotte said?
I can have empathy just because, but I can be sick and tired of welcome to my own country. When it first originated, it was to welcome people into the country who from Polynesia who were performing at a fringe festival in, I think, in Perth. They wanted to be welcomed before they'd perform. I don't have to be welcomed every day to my country. I live here. It gets ad nauseam. I can still have empathy with people. I can still appreciate their views, but I haven't got to be welcomed every single time. I don't get a welcome drink every time you walk past the reception desk. You know, people don't say, oh, welcome. Just once.
Established that you just don't listen to actual Indigenous voices. You've just had someone sit here and tell you the history, how it's relevant to his culture, and you're going to talk about some historical event that you've come up with. Like, open your ears.
So you're quite happy to be welcomed every day to your workplace?
100%.
Oh, okay. Yep, it's a little bit tedious. Yeah. I'm already here, yes.
Okay.
Let the panel
respond to that. How do you, Warren?
Well, I think that this is the problem. This is where it's originally about bringing people together. It's about having this, you know, conversation and everything. And what's happening is it's been trivialised, it's been worn down, and then this is causing the division. In actual fact, we should be getting back to what it really is.
Well, what do you think about Sandra's point there about being constantly welcome to her own country?
Yeah, I'm not sure the circumstances she refers to, but I'm a bit more upset when you trivialise it and say about when you're going to get a drink, you're going to get a welcome for each drink. I think that's where you go over the top and people's reactions are not proportionate to reality. I work every day and we're part of the community who deliver this every day. It doesn't occur like that.
Warren Mundine, Nathan Moran, great to have you both on. Thank you so much for your points this evening. Really appreciate it.